Okay, Michael, which of these two decision trees is smaller?
The one on the right is smaller.
That's exactly right, because it's easier to represent it in sort of almost any obvious way that you can think of. It has fewer nodes. So smaller decision trees, trees with fewer nodes, less depth, whatever you need to make it smaller, have smaller length than bigger decision trees. So that means that if all we cared about was the second term here, we would prefer smaller decision trees over bigger decision trees.
Which we do.
Which we do. Now, what about this over here? The what does it mean? So I think this is pretty straightforward. You got this, right?
That the length of, well, I mean, I guess what's weird is that you're kind of moving back and forth between a notion of a prior, which is where the P of H came from, and a notion of, well, you know, if we're going to actually have to describe the hypothesis, you have to write it down in some way, and this gives you a way of measuring how long it takes to write it down. But I guess what this whole derivation is doing is linking those two concepts so that you can think about our bias for shorter decision trees as actually being the prior, right? And actually being the thing that says the smaller ones are more likely, and vice versa, that when we think about things that are priors that are assigning high probability to certain things, it's kind of like giving them a shorter description.
Right. So, in fact, if you were to take this example literally here, that we prefer smaller trees to bigger trees, this is kind of a Bayesian argument for Occam's razor.
And pruning.
And pruning. Well, you often use razors to prune, so it makes perfect sense.
Ah.
Okay, so this is kind of straightforward, right? That basically smaller trees are smaller than bigger trees. It sort of makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what about this over here? What does it mean to talk about the length of the data given a particular hypothesis?
I could think of one interpretation there. So like if the hypothesis generates the data really well, then you don't really need the data at all, right? You already have the hypothesis. The data is free, right? But if it deviates a lot from the hypothesis, then you're going to have a long description of where the deviations are. So maybe it's kind of capturing this sort of notion of how well it fits.
Right. That's exactly right. So I like that explanation. So let me write it down. So here we literally just mean something like size of H. But over here we're talking about, well, sort of error, right? If the hypothesis perfectly describes the data, then you don't need any of the data. But let's imagine that the hypothesis gets all of the data labels wrong. Then when you send the hypothesis over to this person, this sort of person we're making up who's trying to understand the data and the hypothesis, then you're also going to have to send over what all the correct answers were. So what this really is a notion of misclassification error, or just error in general, if we're thinking about regression. So basically what we're saying is, if we're trying to find the maximum a posteriori hypothesis, we want to maximize this expression. We want to find the H that maximizes this expression. That's the same as finding the H that maximizes the log of that expression, which gives you this, which is the same as minimizing this expression, which is just maximizing this expression and throwing a minus one in front. But these terms actually have meanings in information theory. So really, the best hypothesis, the hypothesis with the maximum a posteriori probability, is the one that minimizes error and the size of your hypothesis. So you want the simplest hypothesis that minimizes your error.
Whoa, that's pretty much literally Occam's razor.
Yes. Now, what is important here in reality is that these things are often traded off with one another. If I give a more complicated or bigger hypothesis, I can typically drive down my error, or I can have a little bit of error for a smaller hypothesis. But this is a sort of fundamental trade-off here. You want to find the simplest hypothesis that still explains your data, that is, minimizes your error.
Hmm.
So this actually has a name, and that is the minimum description length. And there have been many algorithms over the years that have tried to do this directly by simply trading off some notion of error and some notion of size and finding the trade-off between them that actually works. Now, if you think about it for a little while, Michael, you'll realize that, yeah, this sort of makes sense at the hand-wavy level at which I just talked about it, but you do have some real issues here about, for example, units. So I don't know if the units of the size of the hypotheses are directly comparable to the counts of errors or sum of squared errors or something like that. And so you have to come up with some way of translating between them and some way of making a decision whether you would rather minimize this or you would rather minimize that if you were forced to make a decision. But the basic idea is still the same here, that the best hypothesis is the one that minimizes error without paying too much of a price for the complexity of the hypothesis.
Wow. So I've been sitting here thinking about, so with decision trees, this notion of length feels like you could translate it directly into bits, right? Like if you actually had to write it down and transmit it, that makes a lot of sense. But then I was thinking about neural networks. And given a fixed neural network architecture, it's always the same number of weights. And they're just numbers, so you just transmit those numbers. So I thought, this isn't really helping us understand neural nets at all. And then it occurred to me that those weights, if they get really big, you're going to need more bits to express those big weights. And in fact, that's exactly when we get overfitting with neural nets, if we let the weights get too big. So like this gives a really nice story for understanding neural nets as well.
Right. The complexity is not in the number of parameters directly, but in what you need to represent the value of the parameters.
Wow.
So I could have 10 parameters that are all binary, in which case I need 10 bits, or they could be arbitrary real numbers, in which case I might need, well, an arbitrary number of bits.
That's really weird.
Yeah. But the point here, Michael, I want to wrap this up. The point here is we've now used Bayesian learning to derive a bunch of different things that we've actually been using all along. And so, again, the beauty of Bayesian learning is that it gives you a sort of handle on why you might be making some of the decisions that you're making.
It seems like this raises the theory question that you threw at me in a previous unit, right? Which is like, well, so if it doesn't really tell us anything that we didn't already know, how important is it?
Well, in this case, I think it's important because it told us something that we were thinking and tells us that, in fact, we were right. So now we can comfortably go out in the world minimizing sum of squared error when we're in a world where there's some kind of Gaussian transmission noise. We can go about trying to believe Occam's razor because Bayes told us so, thanks to Shannon, and so on and so forth. We can do these things and know that, in some sense, they're the right thing to do, at least in a Bayesian sense.
Neat.
Okay, good. Now, one more thing, Michael, I'm going to show you, which is that everything I've told you so far is a lie.